Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from one of the pastors here at the Rock.
Praise God. Stay standing and we're going to go right ahead and pray. Is that okay? Hallelujah. I'm going to go down on my knees and just ask God to be with us tonight. Because again, you didn't come tonight to hear from a man or a woman or from both. But tonight you came to hear from God. Amen? So let's just bow our heads before the Lord. Father, thank you for the privilege we have to be in your house tonight. Anytime we can come together as your people, Lord, we're so aware of your presence. And we covet that presence, Lord, because there's no better place than that. And we need your presence. We confess we need your wisdom. Thank you for your word tonight that can teach us. Can teach us how to be better parents, how to be the families that will bring honor to your name. Tonight, Lord, every one of us, we're struggling with many issues, but tonight, thank you for your Holy Spirit that can equip us and for all of us to walk out here different than when we came in. And Lord, we'll give you the praise and the glory for what you can accomplish in your house tonight. Everybody in agreement say,
amen.
Amen. Well, it is truly a blessing and an honor for us to be standing in front of you here tonight. Anytime we get this privilege, you know, especially with Pastor Jim and Deborah sitting on the front row, I mean, we are absolutely in fear and trembling. Because don't we serve just the best pastors on the planet? Pastor Jim and Deborah are amazing people, our senior pastors, all the pastors here on staff. We are just so blessed to be on a great team. And tonight I'm blessed to be able to stand next to my wonderful wife of how many years now? 30-some?
30-some.
Yeah, 30-some. And and we're just grateful that we can have a testimony of God's goodness in our hearts and in our lives, of God's faithfulness through all the years. Parenting is a tough job. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Is there anybody that think parenting is easy? I don't think there's anybody that think parenting is easy. It's a tough job. But I'm grateful that in all the years that we've been together, God has truly blessed me with a wonderful, I call her my better half. Because when it comes to parenting, I think Eleanor has just an amazing gift to really speak into the lives of our children.
That's very sweet of you. Thank you. But, you know, the best kept secret is really the brains in the outfit. So I've been honored to be here at The Rock we are in our 10th year serving here at The Rock. Can you believe it's been that long? And it's been the greatest honor for us to fall in love with all of you here at The Rock. We've come a long ways to get to here because we started out halfway around the globe, on the other side of the globe. And following God, you always know where you start, but you never know where you're going to end up. So here we are. We have, my husband went through seminary in South Africa, and we had a two-year-old daughter when we came over to the United States for the first time. And it has been an amazing experience ever since he went to Regent University. And so our parenting was a little bit different in the sense of cross-cultural parenting, if you want to say that, because we came into a fresh new culture. We talk funny. We eat funny stuff. We, you know, people don't laugh. When people laugh, when we first came to the States, we'd be in company of people, and somebody would say something, and everybody laughs, and I look at him, and they're like, what was that? What was funny? I don't know. What was, you know, the sense of humor is different. So it's quite a challenge. It was a challenge for us to raise kids in a different culture. But you know what the truth is? If you are a believer and you are in the kingdom of God, you are also raising kids in a different culture. Because the culture of the world is the kingdom of darkness that wants your kids.
Yep.
But it's the cross-cultural experience. It's really true for all of us. But yes, so we served, we came back, we pastored in South Africa, came back and raised our kids in South Africa as well as in Virginia. And when we came to California 9 years ago, we felt, okay, how, why did it take us so long to finally get home?
Hallelujah.
So it was an amazing experience. And, you know, talking about parenting truly is the most humbling thing for me. It's been the greatest honor that God has given us these amazing kids to raise. But it's very humbling because we're not perfect. You know, I look at the videos and in preparation for this, how you're not supposed to raise your voice at your kids. And I'm thinking, I did that. You're not supposed to do this. And I did that. And I'm like, oh, I did so many things so wrong. But this is not about being a perfect parent. It is because it is about us serving a perfect God. So when we talk to you tonight, it's not because we got it all figured out. We just want you to invite you to pull up your chairs and let's just tell you what we have learned through the years, 29 years now of parenting.
And really, you know, I really believe God is doing something amazing in these last days. How many of you know that we're in the last days? I want to remind you of a scripture. Actually, the last two verses in the Old Testament, we're going to go there first. And just remind you about something. Malachi, if you look at the scripture in Malachi, chapter 4, the last two verses. Now, how many of you know the very last words, you know, are very important of somebody? Now, the last two verses of the Old Covenant, I think, speaks quite something. And the very last two verses says, "Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord." Verse 6 comes along and says, and he will turn the hearts. Everybody say, turn the hearts. He will turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the hearts of the children to their fathers, lest I come and strike the earth with a curse. How many of you would love for God to strike the earth with a curse? No, none of us like curses. So I guess, you know, we need to listen because God is busy doing something. Now, some of you are sitting here and saying, well, that's, you know, Old Testament. And where is Elijah? Is Elijah going to come and talk to us? Well, actually, in the New Testament, in Luke chapter 1, we see that, you know, there's already somebody that came and did just that. If you look in Luke 1, verse 17, basically what we find here is the angel talking about John that's coming, John the Baptist. Everybody know about John the Baptist? And he said he will also go before him in the, talking about Jesus, in the spirit and the power of Elijah to turn the hearts. Everybody say, turn the hearts. To turn the hearts of the fathers to the children. So actually what we're talking about is there is a spirit. There's a force that, thank God, he is busy doing. And I believe he's right here tonight. His name is the Holy Spirit. And God wants to, through the Holy Spirit, touch hearts and lives, and he wants to turn hearts in this house tonight. Are you ready for that? Are you ready for that? I mean, hearts are complicated things, and it's tough. But with God, all things are possible. Amen? And so that's my prayer and my desire for tonight, for God to just touch our hearts and to do some turning in our hearts.
Yes, and we're talking about parenting, but it's a relationship. So if you don't have children, this is for you too. You will definitely walk away with something because it is the Word of God. You know, coming back to our parenting, we're gonna talk tonight at the hand of our own experience. So the guiding principle, if I look back and I have to think about the guiding principle for us in raising our children, has been, ever since they were very young, to raise God-fearing adults, not cute and witty toddlers and little kids. Ever since they were young, we would think, okay, when they act a certain way, they don't respect authority, they are rude to people or whatever, we would think, how would this play out as an adult? And the result of that is, yes, maybe we were a little serious. You think we were a little serious?
I think so.
Yeah. Looking back, it's like, could we have lightened up just a little bit? But we were fairly, very serious, I would say, and strict on our kids, even from a very young age. We didn't invest in a lot of things in our children outside of God things either. You know, to us, it was church, and it was serving, and it was church, and it was serving. And the kids may have been, Yolandi, I think, would have been a ballerina, probably. She wanted to take ballet when she was little and piano. I could afford piano lessons a couple times. But you know, I could never afford ballet lessons for her. Inside of her, there's a ballerina that still wants to come out. But sorry, baby, we really just didn't have the money for that. Neither did we raise our kids next to the soccer field, next to the ball game, next to the ballet. We just didn't. We just took our kids to church and we figured, let God just do his work in our children. Because remember the guiding principle, God-fearing children. Neil would probably be a world traveler. He loves to travel and see places. And it's like, sorry, maybe someday you can do that. Heinz, our youngest, loved to swim. He played water polo. And we just had to tell the coaches, sorry, it's church. And they would say, but what does one practice? What does one practice make a difference? Well, one church service difference, and we're going to go to church. So sorry, he just couldn't continue. But so, yes, we did fun things. We took them on vacations. But for the most part, it was about church and about serving. And you know,
it was the routine, you know, go to church, go back home.
Do you remember?
Go to school, go to church, go back home, go to school.
We still do. It's like, and I would not have it any different way. Yeah. In a million years, not have it any different way. So we forgot our kids under the pews, too.
Oh, Lord of mercy.
Locked up the church, turned out all the lights.
Do you think we're perfect
kids?
Get
home.
I mean, parents, no perfect parent leave their kids at the church when it's dark. Everybody's gone. The church are locked. And we're in the car, we're talking about the sermon, we talk about, you know, Aunt so-and-so, Auntie so-and-so.
I thought you put Heinz in the car. No, I thought you put Heinz in the car. You're the mom, yeah, but you're the dad. So Heinz was not in the car.
Yep.
Heinz was fast
asleep.
We did that. In the dark church under the pew.
Yep.
But he hopefully doesn't remember that, so he's not here. He's working tonight, so good. Don't want him to have to need psychological help. Anyway, so also as immigrant parents, I mentioned it before, I'm an immigrant mom, and you know, there was a juggle there. We wanted to raise our children according to God, but so in a different culture, it was key for us to define what was going to go in this house and what was not going to go.
Mm.
Because we wanted our children to be able to function in this world, okay? They have to be able to function and relate so they can reach the world. But we also did not want to alienate them from our culture. So, you know, it was quite a juggle there. Mm-hmm. And when I think about that, you know, we left people and things behind. We went as immigrants. It was not, oh, mom, can you take the kids tonight? Or somebody is sick. Or we were pretty much left by ourselves. And we've also parented through extreme trauma in our lives.
Which made for a very close family. You know, we were really, I think, growing up, if you ask our kids, they will all tell you, actually, they're grateful for the fact that we were such a close family. And it was just because of necessity. Yeah.
Even when the youngest was in middle school, and the kids would remember this, so Henny and I would try to run away upstairs, just have adult conversation, you know, just
alone time. So, does anybody sometimes want some alone time?
So we would talk to each other and say, okay, let's go in the bedroom and let's just see how long it takes. Let's watch our clock before all the kids are in the same room. So we would be in the room.
Yep.
And sure enough, the first one would find us. Now they're middle school and older. The first one would find us. Oh, wow, come on in. Sit down on the bed. Let's talk. And then not long after, number two comes in. And before we know, all five of us on one bed. And it's like,
and
seriously.
It was especially fun when we had a water bed. You know?
Yeah, lots of good memories on that. But yeah, we were sometimes the five of us. What are you guys thinking? Seriously, come back. We're talking about parenting. Seriously, can you believe when they want to? Anyway, but you know, to just wrap up the immigrant thing, it just dawned on me, every one of you. You may be all-star Americans and very American in everything you do, but the fact is, you are raising kids cross-culturally. You're raising kids in the kingdom of light in a world that is dark. So you're also going to have to leave some things behind. define what goes in this house and keep them attached and in love with God.
Yep, so true, so true. So, you know, as a dad, I want to talk to you about the role of the dad. And it was something that's very important to me from the beginning. You know, my mom, when I was a kid, she told me, I think one time, my name, Hendrik, it means head of a house. And so I heard that and I said, oh, that's a pretty important job that I have someday. And so I really took that really serious, especially, you know, having kids. And I prayed a lot about how I can be a good dad. I wanted to be not just a good dad, I wanted to be a godly dad. And I obviously, preaching the word a lot, you know, I was in the word a lot, and I would see the heart of our Heavenly Father. I would read Psalm 23. Everybody knows Psalm 23. The heart of the Father is that we would be shepherded. He would want to be our shepherd. He would be there for us, protecting us, you know, making sure that we're safe, that we are provided for. And that's always the kind of heart that I would want to have, I wanted to have for my kids. And I did the best we can, you know, to raise them in a way that they felt that they had a dad that really cared about them, that really loved them, that was always there for them. You know, the church didn't come first. My kids, if they had a problem or an issue, my wife had a problem, they'd come first. And, you know, everything had to wait because they were a priority for me. And I think they knew that growing up. But, you know, I think everybody's heard that part about the job of a father. So I want to go on with another part that I think is very important. And you find that if you look in your Bible, open your Bible in 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. 1 Thessalonians, the second chapter. And I think you hear this actually a lot here in this house, because we are blessed with such great pastors. You hear this a lot. But I'm going to just go back there and emphasize that tonight and tell you how important this is. 1 Thessalonians 2, verse 11 and 12. Look at verse 11. Paul is talking to the church in the Thessalonian church, and he says, as you know, how we exhorted and comforted and charged every one of you as a father does his own children. So he's saying there, this is what a father does. A father exhort, a father would comfort. And you know, as a father, our job really is to know our kids in such a way that when we see that they're going through tough times, we are there to exhort them and to comfort them and to be there for them to the best of our ability, to help them through those times as kids that they go through too. And the whole family, as a matter of fact. As a father does his own children. But then he goes on and he says, remember he said he charged them. Charged them with what? That you would walk worthy of God. That's the charge that a father always should have for his children. That's the thing that a dad should press into the hearts of his children all the time, that they should walk worthy of God, who calls you into his own kingdom and glory. Listen, that's really, to me, that's the most important job of a dad. If you don't do whatever you can to help your kids to walk worthy of God, you're missing it in doing your job as a dad. What does it mean to walk? It means living out life. Pastor Jim talks about that a lot. In other words, you have to know them well enough that you can help them to live their lives in such a way that they would be worthy of God, that they would live lives that will honor God. That's your job. as a dad. And there are plenty of examples in Scripture of fathers. Some of them were not so good fathers. I recall, for instance, Eli in 1 Samuel chapter 3, verse 13. You recall the story of Eli that knew that his sons were doing things. As a matter of fact, in the church, they were in the temple in those days, serving in the temple, and they had sex with some of the other women in the temple courts. Crazy stuff. And the scripture says, if you go to 1 Samuel 3, for I told him that I would judge his family forever because of the sin he knew about. His sons blasphemed God, and he failed to restrain them. So this whole issue of you having a responsibility as a dad to help your kids to walk worthy of God is a very serious issue. Listen, guys, listen. Your job as a parent, God called you as a parent to a very important job. It's your responsibility to help them. They're just kids. And you have to help them. They're foolish. They will do foolish things. Kids do foolish things. Can I get an amen? Boy, can they do foolish things. When they're little, you laugh at it. You think, that's funny. As they get bigger, you don't want to laugh so much anymore. Little kids, little problems. Big kids, bigger problems for sure. But our job as parents are to really help them to walk in a way, to live out life in a way that is worthy of God. You know, many times we think, oh, well, thank God I'm sitting here tonight, my kids, at least my kids are not having such serious sins, you know, they're not having sex with other women in the church, stuff like that. Yes, I'm doing a good job as a father. But you know, there's many things that God hates, that God doesn't want. That God doesn't want in the family situation at all. And if just in Proverbs 6, there's seven things God hates. A proud look, a lying tongue, hands that shed innocent blood, a heart that devises wicked plans, feet that are swift in running to evil, a false witness who speak lies, and one who sows discord among brethren. All those things talk about relationships. And there are many different relationships within the family, and there are many relationships that your kids and your family is involved in. And all these things, as a dad, our job is to make sure when we see them heading in the wrong direction, the moment we see them going off in the wrong direction, whether it's just an issue in the heart, we can see them start lying about stuff. You have to stop that. Your job is to say, this is not of God. It's your job to say, I will not allow that in this house. You have to keep them godly. You have to help them to say, this is the standard. We live by the word of God. And we're going to follow God. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. That's your job as a dad, in order to help them to grow in the things of God.
You know, I, as you speak, I'm reminded, and I just want to share with you, that if you're sitting in here and you did not have this father that he's talking about, you're in the right place. My husband's dad died when he was just born. He was 11 days old. His biological father died. His mother remarried, but she married Mr. Tall, Dark, and Handsome and not so godly. So she backslid, wasn't a father for him, anything but tough times. Divorced and remarried again. She's a God-fearing woman, but she lost it there because of whatever heartache and, you know, whatever the case may be. So he speak about fathering and he's so passionate about it, but he never had the father figure. But you know what he did have? he had the church.
Yep.
His mom knew one thing, and that is to take her children to church. So listen to Psalm 27, verse 10, that says, "When my father and mother forsake me, then the Lord will take care of me."
Yep.
So then don't get discouraged when you sit here and think you may not have applied all these things, but you, because you didn't have a father figure, just bring your kids to church. Just be in church. Just make God number one. Show your children. God, doesn't matter how old they are or how young they are. If your kids are grown, show your grandkids. It's never too late. But you become the person that be in the house of God, not visit. Like, you know how people buy trees. How many of you have bought trees and plants at Home Depot, took it home, and just put it down, and then left it there for a bit? Just never quite getting to plant it. I've got to plant those trees, but, you know, tomorrow, and tomorrow, and tomorrow. That is like coming to church, but not be planted and rooted. There's only one way to flourish in the house of God, is when you don't just buy the stuff. You come, you dig holes, you get planted, saying, "This is, I'm not moving." And that is when
Amen.
The promises of God will apply to you.
Absolutely.
And just in his life, he saw the church leaders. The church leaders, the men, were the fathers in his life, and that's probably why he ended up in ministry, because he just admired them so much.
But as a dad, I want to tell you, you know, your love for your kids makes all the difference. You have to learn from the love of the Father, God the Father, and learn to love your kids the way he loves us. And that's your job. And so when parents come and see me, you know, as a pastor, I've had so many times parents come in and they want to come and tell me about their kids that are just not listening to them, this wayward kid that they have. And I start talking to them about their relationship as a husband and wife. You know why? Because the best way you can love your kids is by loving each other. And the kids feel loved when you, as parents, love each other. They feel loved. It's true. And so many times they would come and complain about the kid, but really the kid is many times, not always, but many times, is a product of a problem in a relationship where they are not loved the way they're supposed to love, be loved. And what I'm saying to you as a dad, you have to watch for all the different relationships in the house. And all of them need to be godly. You need to watch for all the hearts in the house, and all of them are following God and are running after God to the best of their ability. Because otherwise, you know, when there's not real godliness and there's not real love in the house, you can read all the parenting books in the world. It's not going to do you any good. It's not going to do anything for you. It is God's love that is translated through you as parents into the hearts of the kids, and they grow up healthy, godly, strong kids that can walk worthy of God.
And that is God's plan.
That
is God's first
absolutely.
Plan, but he is also our redeemer. Like in my husband's life, when he did not have the dad, you know, to do all those things. Just remember, Jesus Christ is our redeemer. He redeems
Amen.
Those things. He redeems the mistake we've all made. He redeems he fills in the gaps. If you put God number one, then signs, wonders, miracles, and gifts are in operation, and miracles happen in your house.
I have to quickly just throw this in also for free, okay, for free. Kids need love. They don't need money. Some of you think, I just, you know, feel so guilty because I don't have time with my kids. I don't have time to really spend with them so they can really feel loved. It doesn't take money, okay? I remember as parents, there were many times Christmas where we didn't have money for gifts and stuff. You know where we'd go? We'd go to the dollar store. Every kid gets $5 and they can pick out 5 gifts. That's it. That was Christmas. And you know what? They are all wonderful, healthy kids. And actually, the best gifts they remember are those dollar store gifts. Isn't that amazing? It is the heart. It is the heart yeah. that is most important.
I think of a beautiful bracelet that one of my kids gave me in later years. And then I think when he was a little toddler, he gave me this Santa Claus hanging on a bell. We were talking about bells. You know, the dollar store red little bell with Santa Claus. I mean, that was in little snow globe and things like that. Dollar items. And then you can make it work. So I'm going to go ahead and, with the permission of my children, just really quickly go through a couple things. As I was praying about this, talking about the role of the father and the role of the mom, I said to the Lord, what is it, God, that you want me to say? It's so many years, it's so many amazing things and so many beautiful teachings that we've already heard. And God spoke to me. He said to me, what has parenting taught you? And I'm like, me? What did it teach me? And then I realized, as I started listening to the Lord, I realized that each one of my three children taught me something about parenting. And I just want to briefly go through it. Each child was unique. And really looking back, three major principles emerged that defined our parenting and taught us the life lessons that shaped us as parents. First of all, there was our Yolandi. Yolandi is now, 29 years old, accomplished in her career. She arrived with action in the family. Number one, and Yolandi was born and everybody knew Yolandi entered the world. There was no question about it. The neighbors and their neighbors and their neighbors and everybody knew. Yolandi was very verbal from the start. Yolandi was crying. She was colicky. She was never quite satisfied with anything. She's a perfect kid. I love her. Okay, she said I could say this. But Yolandi entered the world with a big bang. And she was Miss Action. You know, she likes to get attention. She was the kid that crawled on my lap and took my face when I was talking to somebody and say, Mommy, look at me. Listen to me, Mommy. You know, that kid. She was that one. And nothing much has changed. But she was, let's go do something, Mom. Let's just take action. She was a very verbal child. So speaking verbally to her on the moment, face to face, you know, was the way to go with her. When you saw something that time, she was a little toddler. I tell you guys, she was not 2 years old. She broke open a little onion that she felt in that she found in the kitchen, and I found her with just the onion peels. Now, you know, we did not know not to make mountains out of molehills. Oh, she did that. She needs to clean up. You know, don't start battles you can't finish. I started the battle with the onion, and I still don't remember, did I really win that battle? I was learning. So I said, Yolandi, pick up. You made a mess here, pick up. Not going to pick up. I'm like, okay. I said, you will pick up. And I got real firm with her. I pulled her 2-year little hands down. I sat down and I pulled her hands down to the onion. And I said, pick it up. And she's like, No. She just absolutely refused when she didn't want to do something. She was just simply not going to do it. You know, she, as a teenager, when she stomped her feet, slammed the door. You all know about that. Stomping feet up the stairs, slamming the door. When it was Yolandi, no. Nip it in the butt right there. I would stomp my feet following her, open her door. And do you remember that, baby? I'm sorry. Have you forgiven me? No, I would get face to face with her that day because I saw her heart was someplace else. I got in her face and I said to her, look at this face. This is your mother and this is the only mother you're ever going to have. This is the best thing that's ever happened to you, or this could be your worst nightmare ever. And I am not going to go away. I'm going to be here when you go to bed. I'm going to be here when you get up. I'm going to be here when you're good. I'm going to be here with your bed. So have a good look, baby. I'm in your face. Something just came over me and I said, heck no. No. But still till this day, I don't do that anymore. But she would call me on her way to work. She's on her way very early in the morning, didn't sleep, have two kids, keep her out of, she has 7 or 9 patients to see, a seminar to offer at 12 o'clock, didn't get time to get dressed, and she calls me freaking out, Mom, I don't think I'm going to do that. I don't know. I don't even have makeup on. And I'm like, Yolandi, stop. It's that in your face kind of thing. Yolandi, stop, stop, stop. Let me tell you what to think, baby. Let's think. And then I just guide her and guide her. And then she says, oh, that feels better, mommy. So she's just the in your face, deal with the issue kind of child. And we learn to give kids the truth. You know that scripture, we don't have time all to read the whole, but in Ephesians 4, that talks about speak the truth in love. There are times, and we've learned that sometimes discerning the heart of the child, you have to immediately speak. Because the Bible here says, but speaking the truth in love, they may grow up in all things unto him who is the head. So with her was face-to-face, action child. It led her to a lot of accomplishments in her life, and it's amazing, but that is who Yolandi was, and that is what she taught us. It doesn't matter if it feels good to you or not. You have to follow the path that God has for you. Then came Mr. Neil. Mr. Neil, our second baby, was born, and oh boy, was that different. He was a child born with multiple medical challenges. He had low blood platelets. He did not respond the way we expected with his eyes. The doctors told us he was blind. He had so many needles stuck into him. Hearing him cry, they would shoo me out of the room. And I remember the one time they couldn't find veins anywhere. They put, what is it? Why do you do that to kids? Seriously, put this thing in his head. What do you, I mean, the line, here my baby comes out with a needle stuck in his head to get the medicine in his body. And specialist after specialist, other states and specialties, checking him out. And it was just suddenly we were just, you know, into a situation we were not prepared for. But you know what that taught us? It was like, okay, now here we have a situation. Yes, we believe in prayer, but this one was stronger. We needed take out the big guns for this. Mm. So this child taught us how to fast, how to go to the enemy's camp and take back what the enemy has stolen
fight,
from our kids.
Fight, 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 fight.
Yes.
That's what we had to do.
I remember sitting over him. Then he was a toddler. He started getting seizures. So I knew what it looked like when a seizure was coming on. I remember nights sitting through the night just watching him, and I see the signs of seizures, and I curse that thing, and I curse that thing all night through, and I pray, and I fast, and God gave me a vision, and I saw our house with this huge angel. I saw just the blades of a sword, you know, shining in the moonlight. There was an angel on the roof of my house with his sword going, and I saw angels. With this child, I saw angels, and I confronted demons in his life. But he taught us that sometimes, like Daniel, Daniel 10, go read the story, that Daniel was praying for a revelation. Took 3 weeks he was praying. And the angel came to him with a message and said, I heard you the first time, but I got opposition from the king of Persia, king of the ruler of the air, demonic resistance, getting the answer to him. He was fasting for 3 weeks when finally the fasting had something to do with that angel winning, the angel of Satan, to try to prevent that the answer to come through. So boy,
standing in the gap.
Absolutely.
For your kids.
And he's still, Neil is our field child. You know, we would sit around the table and we'd say, when he was younger. So Neil, it was just like entertainment for us. We would say, Neil, very young, tell us a little bit what you think of us. And he would take us one by one and he would just analyze us and analyze us. He has a very deep sense, and he's like, oh, he knows that, he can see that. It was like a frightening, you know, gift he had to just feel things, and he's an amazing child. And the lesson was we learned to celebrate accomplishments.
Yep.
Every little thing. The doctor said, this baby is not going to roll over. Mm. The day he rolled over, you should have seen us.
Yes.
Doctor said, he's not going to walk anytime soon. Then he walked. Boy, we had a party. So it taught us how to celebrate milestones, how to appreciate everything. When God opened his eyes, the first time he ever looked at a toy, I have it on a picture. The first time he fixed his eyes on a toy, God restored his sight. So we saw miracles and we learned how to fight.
So yeah, I guess what you're saying, baby, is that, you know, as parents, you have to watch their hearts, you know, like in Yolandi's case, you watch their hearts, but you also see when God is doing something amazing, you teach them how to celebrate, and you teach them about celebrating God in their hearts. So you watch their hearts so that their hearts can grow in a way that they appreciate God for all the things that he does.
Yeah. Well, I'll take 60 seconds. How about that? Child number three. This is the story of his life. I came along third. I wore all the hand-me-downs. Here we go again. I talked about the two. There's no time for Mr. Hines now. That's a story of the life of the youngest child.
Yes.
But let me just tell you, then Hines came along. The doctors told us don't have any more children because we don't know what was happening with Neil. You have another child, especially another son, same thing can happen. And then, well, that was what doctors said. We'd never really mind that much in our lives. So God gave us this child. Here Hines came along and he was Mr. and baby, calm, collected, committed, calculated, hard person. If I had to confront him like I did Yolandi, he probably would have, I don't know what would have, he was just not that child. He was the child with Yolandi, she was always, and Neil to a degree too, they were around and they did things. Hines was the one you had to go find him in the house and see what he's up to. But then Hines taught us to pray. He taught us to pray. I have to tell you this story. There was one time I was in, he was in middle school and he had all the girls. Do you know that the girls follow the guys in middle school? Am I supposed to say that? Something about that? But the girls, you know, it was like, oh, these girls, man, they are just not, you know, letting grass grow under their feet. Anyway, and I was concerned about some of the possible relationships coming forth out of that. And I was on a Saturday morning in my room and I was praying. And I opened the Bible and it's where God says, you shall not marry these foreign women. Blah, 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 blah. And I knew it was for Hines. I knew it. And I said, God, I cannot go tell Hines this. He would be so offended. And how do I do this? But why did you just give me the scripture when I prayed for Hines? I said, okay, Lord, seriously, guys, just on my knees in my room. If you send him in my room, I will know. As God is my witness. Maybe 60 seconds. There was a knock at the door. Hey, Mom? Yes? Can I come in? Guess who it was? It was Hines. And I'm like, sure, son, come on in. He came in and I looked him in the eye. I said, you would not believe what is just happening right now.
Yep.
I talked to him about it yesterday. He still remembers it like yesterday. I said, I was praying for you. I still got this. You walked in. So this is a God moment, all of that. And I said, let me read you this. And his eyes just got bigger and bigger and bigger. And it's like, this message is for you. And he was like, oh my goodness, God has my name and number. I remember then you went off to college. You went to UCLA for 4 years, guys. We had to let the kid go, not knowing what was going on. You don't want to know what's going on UCLA campus either. So one day we were in the car driving him back, and I will never forget. I always said, Hines, I'm praying for you. Our pastors were amazing. They told us, just leave him. He will come back. We didn't know where he was. He had to go find his way to God for himself. Took a lot of faith from us. So I'm sitting next to him in the car, taking him back to campus. And I said, well, Hines, you know, I just want you to know I'm praying for you. And I said, and I'm praying that God would just make you miserable when you're in the wrong company. And he looked at me, he said, Mom, why would you pray such a thing? He was stunned because he obviously may have found he's miserable, but, you know, in the wrong company. But this was... With Hines, it was, we could not always confront him the same way in a harsh way. So it taught us to pray it through. And God is faithful. He came through that unscathed, learned a lot, and has decided to follow Jesus. He figured probably he can run, but he cannot hide because, you know, of the prayers of his parents. So
Yeah, I'm grateful that, you know, my daughter have listened to her dad, and she married a godly man that loves God. I tell all my kids, you find a godly spouse. Go find your spouse in church, somebody that runs after God. Because remember, your job as a parent is to help them to walk worthy of God. And believe me, the wrong spouse or the wrong friends will pull them away from God, not help them closer to God. And our job as parents is to always watch for who are they associating with and to help them to make godly connections in life. But I want to take a moment and talk to you. If you're a parent in here and maybe you are struggling with some issues in your heart because you've heard what we talked about and you realize that there's some issues that in your family is just not going so good. One of the kids are really going astray, or maybe a couple of them are going astray. And maybe you've even tried to bring them to church all the time, but still they've made choices that are ungodly. And there's some real issues in your heart. And you're struggling with all of that. I just feel a burden in my heart tonight to pray for parents that are struggling with kids. You know, there's been just such an anointing here at the Rock here lately. Many times we've opened the altars and we've seen God move in such an amazing way. I feel tonight, from my side, I feel a burden to pray for parents who have broken hearts, broken families, and you just don't know how to fix any of that. Well, I have good news. God can help you. And tonight, if you will just come and just give it to God, just come and surrender to the Lord. I'm going to actually invite you to come because we'd like to pray for you right up here before we even continue on with the service. If you, as a family, you feel you need prayer, maybe there's a kid in here and you're struggling with your relationship with your parents, you need to come. You need to come so I can pray for you. It's God's desire for the whole family to walk worthy of God. So just come.
It's not God's plan for you after you've raised your kids to walk around with guilt and condemnation. Jesus Christ is our Redeemer. So if you cry out, say, oh God, I didn't know you, I didn't understand, I just have the load of the world on me in the form of guilt. This is your night that you're going to leave it right here because Jesus died for that and He is your Redeemer. He will change the hearts of stone into hearts of flesh. And He wants to start with you. Just forgive yourself. Forgive yourself. Let it go. And start anew. If you are young moms, to you young moms and dads sitting here saying, oh my God, help, help, help us raise our kids in a godly way. I need help, God. I do not have all the answers. So as you're up front here, just close your eyes.
Just
connect with God.
Yeah, before you continue, my love, you know, the restorer of hearts are here. The restorer of hearts are here. And He wants to restore some hearts. You know, raising kids, having a family is not easy. And I want to just tell you up front, it's not easy. It's never easy. It only becomes better when you have God in the picture. And so, you know, there is not a family, even the ones that are still sitting down. I can tell you, I can assure you, there's not a single family without problems. I think the key is to learn how to get rid of the trash, so to speak. You know, a successful, a godly family is one that learn how to take out the trash regularly. All right, you don't let that trash sit in your house to really just bring disease into the house. You have to take it out on a consistent basis. And tonight, that's part of what I'd like to do. Because there's stuff in your heart that shouldn't be there. God doesn't want it to be there. Unforgiveness, even towards yourself. Bitterness. God doesn't want it to be there. He wants to restore your heart, first towards Him, and then towards each other. So tonight, just listen to what the Word says in 1 John 1, verse 9. If you confess your sins, and how many of us have sinned? How many of us have shortcomings? How many of us have made mistakes? Is there somebody that can say, yes, I've made mistakes? You know what? God says, if you confess that, He is faithful. Did you hear what He said? He said, He is faithful and just, and He will forgive you. And God can forgive you tonight. You may stand here tonight and you may feel you've made the biggest mistakes anybody could ever have made with kids, or, you know, kids towards parents. Listen, God can forgive. He wants to cleanse your heart. He wants to restore your heart tonight. So tonight, God is here to help you so that you can go to that next level. And I'm going to start and I'm going to pray, and my wife will also pray after me. So just bow your heads and let me pray for you. Father, these are your people, your children, Father. And tonight, Lord, all the complex issues of the hearts and the relationships, you know about it all. Nobody can restore like you can. The hurt, you know about it all. And tonight I pray for parents, Father, that are just confused, struggling with guilt and all kinds of issues in their heart. I know that's the chains of the devil that he's trying to strangle them with. And I refuse, devil, you have no right in the lives of these parents, of these people. Thank you, Lord, that tonight you set them free, that there's no more guilt, no more shame. Lord, you wash them tonight, and they can walk away from here tonight free from all guilt and shame, because you're the one that forgive them. Just pray after me. Say, Father, tonight I come to you, and I ask your forgiveness. Help me, Lord, to also forgive myself just the way you forgive me, in Jesus' name.
Lord, I pray for this beautiful and amazing group of people that also tonight is saying you are number one. God, they've realized they cannot do this alone. It just doesn't work without you. So as they come tonight and bow their hearts before you, I ask that you give them a hunger and a thirst after you like never before. Lord, that they will run after you with everything that is within them. God, that they will make your word and your house and your name and your kingdom a priority in their life, that they will truly come and be rooted and planted in the house of the Lord, so that your promise can be fulfilled in the life, that they shall flourish in the courts of the Lord. Yes. So just see the hearts, Father, that come before you and recommit to make you number one. Because God, there is no other way. There's no other way to live this life in these relationships but to put you number one. Just fill them, Lord, Holy Spirit. Just fill all those holes. Fill where there's loneliness. Fill where there's broken relationships, Lord. Just fill their hearts. Heal the wounds now in the name of Jesus. Restore, oh God, like, yes, only Lord, you can restore.
In Jesus' name, everybody say, amen. Amen. Give God a praise. Just thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. He's the restorer. Now you walk in the victory. Go take your seats. Hallelujah. Now, before you go tonight, I have something most important to do still. Because all the stuff that we just talked about You know, it doesn't work unless first your relationship with God is right. And tonight I really have to talk to some of you. You came in here tonight and, you know, you think maybe if I should ask you this very important question. If you died tonight, if you walk out of here and all of a sudden your heart stops, where would you open your eyes? In heaven or in hell? And you're saying to me, Pastor, I think I'll go to heaven. I have to talk to you. Because you see, nowhere in Scripture do I find where you can just think that you're going to go to heaven. And you're going to go to heaven. Or maybe you say, Pastor, I hope that I will go to heaven. You see, again, nowhere in the Scripture can I find where you can just hope that you're going to go to heaven and that you'll go to heaven. You see, God is very clear about us going to heaven. It's His heaven. And if we want to go to His heaven, we need to do it His way. Jesus, as a matter of fact, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one goes to the Father but by me. So you can't go to heaven just because you think you're going to go to heaven, just because you think you live in America, or that you think you're a Christian, you know, you're coming to church all the time, and you think you're doing the right thing. It doesn't work. You have to do it God's way. And Jesus made it very clear. While he was here on earth, as a matter of fact, he came to a man by the name of Nicodemus. And if anybody was a great man, Nicodemus was a great man. Nicodemus knew the Scripture. I mean, he could sing the Scripture. He taught the Scripture. And Nicodemus talked to Jesus about eternity. And you'd think that Jesus would just pat him on the back and say, Nicodemus, don't worry. Heaven is waiting for you. Such a great man like you, you know, always giving your money to the poor, caring about others. You'd think Jesus would pat him on the back and say, heaven is waiting for you, but he doesn't. He looked at Nicodemus and he said, Nicodemus, you must be born again. Now, even Nicodemus that knew the Scripture couldn't understand that. He didn't understand what it meant to be born again. And many of you sitting here tonight, you don't understand what does it mean to be born again. Jesus said to him, no, I'm not talking about a natural birth, Nicodemus. I'm talking about a spiritual birth. Spiritually, you must be born again. What does that mean? You see, really, some people think they can come to church every now and then, just show up and, you know, do their church thing, and then they feel good about themselves, have a little bit of God in them, but also serve the world. Doesn't work like that. With God, you either serve Him all the way or you don't serve Him. That's the way it is with God. As a matter of fact, Jesus, He said, I'm coming again. And when I come, I better find you hot or cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you out of my mouth. What is he saying? He's saying, I hate it when people are lukewarm. And so, born again, what that means is that you have decided, you're going to give God all of your heart and all of your life. That's what it means to be born again. Now, I know, you know, Hollywood and the media, movies, they've made fun of people that call themselves born again. Because there are some people that call themselves born again, but they don't live the life of giving God all their heart, all their life. They live foolish lives. And so they make fun of people like that. I don't care what movies say, the media say. I care what God says. God says you must be born again. It's something that has to happen in your heart, in every one of our hearts, where we make a decision to give God all of our hearts and all of our life. And tonight, I want to give you that opportunity. Maybe you've never done this. You've never given God all of your heart and all of your life. Friend, I want to make sure you walk out of this place tonight that you're sure Where are you going to go someday? You're going to go to heaven and not go to hell. So tonight's your night. You've never done this? Tonight's your night. Maybe you're just not sure. Tonight, why don't you make sure? Tonight's your night. Maybe you've been running away from God instead of running to God. I'm talking to you tonight. Tonight's your night. So here's what we're going to do. Obviously, we're going to do it God's way, right? Because there's no better way than always doing it God's way. Jesus said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father. So in a moment, I'm going to count to three, and I'm going to ask you to raise your hand. I'm going to go to one, two, three, and I'm going to just clap my hands like that. And everybody's going to do it at the same time, so nobody feels awkward just doing it by yourself. We'll all do it at the same time, okay? So in a few moments, if you've been running away from God instead of to God, tonight's your night. Why don't you give God tonight all of your heart and all of your life? If you're not sure, why don't you make sure tonight? You see, relationship with God is not just something that's in your head. Listen to me. Listen. Look at me. It's not what you have in your head. We say it to you all the time. It's what's in your heart. Tonight, why don't you make sure in your heart that you've given God all of your heart and all of your life? Are you ready? Here it is. If you're not sure, tonight's your night. Make sure. If you've been running away from God instead of to God, talking to you. Tonight's your night. You ready? Here it is. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Let me see your hands. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. Anybody else? Eight wise people already in the house. Anybody else? God is speaking to you. It's your night. It's your night. Don't let the devil steal one more day from you walking in uncertainty, not being sure. Why don't tonight you make sure? Anybody else? Eight wise people already. Thank you. I see that hand. Nine. Ten. Thank you. Anybody else? Anybody else? 10 wise people. Anybody else? In the family rooms? Anybody? Anybody? Praise God. All right. Well, let's give God a hand for 10 wise people. Let's praise God. The Bible says when one person comes to God, there's rejoicing in heaven. And we're going to celebrate with you tonight. What we're going to do is in a moment, I'm going to ask everybody to stand up. All of us, we're going to cheer you on. I'm going to ask all 10 of you, bring all your stuff that you brought with you to church. Bring a friend if you need a friend. Come stand here in the front. I'd like to meet you right here. Everybody just stand up together and let's welcome them as they come. All 10 of you, just come quickly. Come quickly. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Just come on quickly. Stand right here.
Up in your hand, lay back again to and breathe. Feel your heartbeat.
Very happy with you, okay?
This love is so deep.
Tonight's your night.
It's more than I can say.
Tonight's your night, my friend. Tonight's your night. Tonight's your night.
It's so
overwhelming. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Tonight's your night. Anybody else? You can still come. You can still come. Anybody else? Tonight's your night, my friend. God bless you. Hallelujah. Now listen, all of you in the front, put a smile on your face. You are going to heaven. This is the best day of your life. I mean, the angels are partying in heaven. They are too happy. Finally, you are making this decision. Here at The Rock, we want to help you. You know, we know now that you've made this decision, the devil hates your guts. He's going to try to stop you from growing and enjoying all the benefits that God has for you. And stop you from feeling the love of God, the joy and the peace of God. So he'll try to stop you from getting back to church. Don't listen to him. get back in church. Let us help you. We're going to help you with that and introduce some people that can help you. People behind you, they're called SPTs, spiritual personal trainers. I'm going to introduce you to people like that that can help you, and we can introduce you to a program that we have to help you through that, okay? We're going to pray with you, and so nothing weird goes on. Let me introduce you to Pastor Mike over here. Pastor Mike's waving at you. He'll take you just to a room back here and quickly pray with you, give you some stuff that you can take home, read more about the decision that you just made, introduce you to these friends. That way you know what we're talking about. So congratulations, everybody. Just make a left turn, follow Pastor Mike.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you. Bye-bye.